The spirit was really coming on strong. It was a late winter snowblow deep in the wilds of northern Montana, and I was a guest of the Assiniboine and the Gros Ventre Indian tribes to hunt the majestic American buffalo deep, deep in the spiritual sacred hunting grounds of this honorable Indian nation. I had pushed snow with my forehead and nose for about a half an hour trying to get close to three rangy, magnificent, beasted on bulls of the herd. And after hours and hours of maneuvering myself into position, I found myself on my knee, looking straight through his heavy winter robe into the ribs that I knew held his vitals. And before I knew it, the arrow had left the corner of my mouth and impacted directly behind the shoulder, vanishing in the majestic beast's side. And with a huff and snow and snot flying, he lurched forward as the three giant bulls headed over the ridge beyond the giant granite rocks. And all became quiet. I finally took a breath. I knew the arrow was good, and I made a small prayer for the wild things. As I walked over the ridge, I saw him down below, the other two bulls milling around, wondering why their leader had fallen in the snow. The wind was horizontal, and though my smile was intense and I was pleased for doing a job well done, I knew that I would be given a gift. Yeah, I hadn't taken this game. I was given a gift by the gods of the hunt. And I slowly approached this magnificent animal with the Indians at my side. And we circled the fallen beast, marveling at his giant size, the sheer magnificence of what is truly the symbol of all things wild and the history of a hunting culture. Apparently gone in the modern world, but alive and well on the wilds of Montana in the winter of 1996. But let me tell you, it wasn't about the arrow. It wasn't about the hunt. What I want to share with you today is about a spirituality, certainly the physics of spirituality that took place, and it takes place every time you're on a hunt, kill or no kill. But let me tell you how the spirit manifested itself that day. For as we knelt at the beast's side, I stroked his incredible rich coat. I touched his massive 14-year-old horns, and I just marveled at the dynamic before me. I didn't rejoice in the death, I didn't rejoice in the kill, but rather a connection that is not available elsewhere. The Indian slapped me on the back and we celebrated because the stalk was fascinating, the presence of the beast was moving, and we were certainly awestruck at what took place there amongst us, sharing a vibrant dynamic that went deep into our hearts. We backed off. The sky was dark, it was blowing hard. It was a horizontal snowblow. One of the young Indians reached deep into his heavy coat and pulled out a beautiful bright green weaved rope, about 4 feet long. He struggled to light the end of it underneath the shelter of his coat. And once the green grass braid was burning a bit, I asked the chief what in fact was happening here. He told me that this sweet grass is harvested in the spring of the year and weaved into these ceremonious ropes. The snow and the wind was blowing the smoke to where you couldn't even see it, but the young Indian warrior waved the smoking rope along his side and knelt down and chanted something I couldn't hear. But the smoke whipped with the hard wind all around the form of this giant buffalo bull in the snow. He handed it to the other Indian, and this Indian did the same, waving the smoke and cupping his hands, kind of drawing what smoke he could into his face. And it had a great smell, I'll tell you. Well, after the three of the Indians had done this, the one chief, we call him Pancho, he handed this smoky rope to me. I'm not really a white guy. On my driver's license, it says semi-Caucasian, so I knew that with a bow and arrow, shoulder to shoulder with red warriors, and the magnificence of this hunt and the beast at my feet dominating the scene, I felt red. I felt like an Indian warrior from the year 5. And I, too, waved the smoking rope at my feet along my body, the wind whipping our coats and whipping the robe of the buffalo, whipping the smoke. As I brought the smoking grass to my face, I, too, cupped my hands. And at the first gesture of bringing this smoke into my face, I swear to God, the wind ceased to howl. It went from a hard, driving, horizontal whip to nothing. And instead of the smoke vanishing from this weave, it slowly wafted above me. It wafted in front of my face. And I could really tell the smell now. Who threw the switch, I don't know. But as the smoke rose, I looked over my head. And there was an eagle circling. You can't write this script. You can't direct this scenario. You can't produce this setting. The hard-driving winter storm ceased to blow. The smoke rose over my head. And the eagle circled me once, twice, three times, pumped his wing hard, and headed due north. At which time, immediately, the wind picked up again. I'm just a man. I can't explain what happened that day, but I think I know what happened that day. That was the physics of spirituality, the spirit of that buffalo, being cleansed and safeguarding us with the smoke of the sweet grass in a great Indian ritual and tradition. The buffalo spirit rose and maybe went to the happy hunting ground, but I know that I took something into my heart that day that could not have been experienced in only two events that I'm aware of: the birth of my children and the death of this majestic resource, this majestic being, a gift to sustain my family and my friends, the tribe and myself, because from the earth and from death comes life. And it's with you all, my friends, I wish to share to you today the spirituality, the dynamic, the charge of time in the wild with bow and arrow in hand. Get yourself a bow and arrow, dig deep and find the spirit within. Discard and abandon the modern baggage of the concrete jungle hellfire storm. Return to a peaceful place from time immemorial. Beyond the pavement is where the spirit soars. And you can get that by becoming a bow hunter. Let me tell you how I do it. You want to get yourself a bow and arrow. You want to find a friend. You want to go down to the local sports shop. Find someone who can instruct you on the simplicity, the grace, the act, the maneuver, the physics of spirituality of archery. Start slow, start relaxed, take your time, breathe deep, and make sure that you shoot a lightweight bow that fits yourself. It's got to feel right. That's the key word with archery. It must be feel. The arrow, the bow, the string, the mystical flight of the arrow, and you must become one. I'm just Ted Nugent, Dad, Motor City Madman, doing that shimmy shimmy cook-a-pop, nasta, boogie-bop, bebop, loo-bop, lamb-bamboo, baby. But let me tell you, the physics of spirituality is alive and well when I got my bow and arrow in my hand and my family at my side, and it's available to everybody. Let me share with you the basics of my instinctive shooting style. I feel so wonderful, like the other night when I made all the right moves, waited for the prime moment, the moment of truth, snugged that release in the corner of my mouth, and sent my personal projectile payload right through the almighty pocket of a beautiful whitetail. A burst run and immediate death by the blade, the slight hump of my compound wheel turning over on my bowl felt as natural as any arrow I have ever cut loose. It felt good. It will always feel good and natural as any recurve or longbow I ever caressed. Grace under pressure. Shooting without sights seems to simplify, even purify, my whole archery bow hunting procedure. The ocean of memories I possess of mystical arrow flights is a source of uncanny joy and stimulation for me. I can close my eyes and see them all, and it's a bunch. This tech tip is about the ultimate unencumbered shooting style with the bow and arrow. Hand-eye coordination at its most pure function and fun. Fun is my specialty. There are a few good books out there on the specifics of instinctive shooting, but I'm going to deal with the basic dynamics of this art form. Some cats got it and some cats ain't. It will come easy for some and will take serious discipline and ultimately loads of practice for the rest of us, myself included. I must constantly work on it to maintain proficiency, but practice is fun. I have seen Fred Bear shoot, and that was all I needed. Latch on to these words a moment. Grace, focus, fluidity. Watch anybody who can really whip a strike ball over home plate sometime. Three-pointers on the basketball court. A long-range bomber across the football field. These guys don't use sights. You will see grace, focus, and fluidity, the likes of which us archers need to perfect. If you ever get a chance to see trick shooter Stacy Grossup or some of the others perform their archery magic, pay close attention to what takes place. Old films of Fred Bear and Howard Hill are amazing, too. Bob Markworth puts on demonstrations all across America and is one of the best. Take notes. Pay attention. The name of the game is feel. It seems I've heard that somewhere before. The bow must become an extension of our own limbs, an extension of our psyche, an extension of our heart and soul. The arrow, a projectile straight from our own eyeballs, like a beacon of light. This will come from repetitive practice. With both eyes open, burn a hole on the exact tiny spot you wish your arrow to vanish into. Envision the flight of the arrow in your mind's eye. Just make it happen. Pay close, immediate attention to every arrow you release, and your mental computer will take notes and imprint the lessons. Do this over and over and over again and again, and you will amaze yourself. Slow and easy, grace, focus, fluidity. Be careful not to use too heavy of a bow. I don't care how tough and macho you might be. Graceful, easy-to-draw equipment is essential. I'm 6'3", 185 pounds, and 40 to 50 pounds is plenty. Not only plenty for the gratification of archery, but plenty for big game hunting in North America. Even less is fine, whatever feels good. In my nearly 47 years of bow hunting experience, I have learned to remain aware of the big picture while at the same time zeroing in on my focus dead center on the target spot. We're talking hairs here. This brings me to the peep sight dilemma. If you decide a peep sight is good for you, go for it. Live it up and the best of luck. But under actual hunting conditions, it is my personal opinion that it is a serious liability. I remember taping a matchstick to my longbow back in the 50s as my first sight pin. It worked as a hold reference, but when game was at stake, it got in the way. I used the first little red and black screw-on sights that Bear Archery made way back when and tried the crosshair and circle pins, laser and red dot sights to where I stick with Bear Bow today. I still play around with all the different sighting methods available, so I'm intelligent about their use. But I prefer Bear Bow. I prefer the pure hand-eye coordination. I can seldom shoot on a par with most of the sight shooters out there on the range, but in the wild, I do just fine. The Nugents are not going hungry. One thing is for sure, you must shoot regularly all year long to stay in tune with your arrow flight. Give it a shot. Take off your sights once in a while, even if you prefer that method. Get real close to your favorite 3D target or your bullseye and learn where your hand and body line up. You will determine where your hold lines are, and you will focus on the grace and fluidity. There is no better practice than that one perfect arrow every day. at your preferred and ideal range. Random shooting is a riot. I use my Zwicky Judo heads and the Muzzy Grasshopper heads or blunts and learn to adapt out in the wild on broken topography. Becoming the human source of your projectile starting point, and even when you return to your sights, you will utilize that natural pointability. It is a natural fluidity, and it really does help. Let me tell you about preparing the mind. There are things out there called people patterns. Being ready for that shot on game is the deciding factor in taking an animal cleanly. The surprise factor can make all the difference in the world. As I have always been told by the masters, particularly us bow hunters, we must see and get ready before the game nails us. It's about an astonishing, probably unprecedented level of awareness we must aspire to. Be careful not to give away our number one hunting strategy by falling into predictable patterns. As we attempt to ambush, sneak up, stalk, and ultimately penetrate game's uncanny defense system, we may give ourselves away through redundancy. Figure for a moment how important it is for us to pattern an animal. Now figure how important it is for us to not be patterned ourselves. Predictability is our nemesis. Adaptability is our ally. I have a few tried and true rules on my own hunting grounds. I make sure that my advanced scouting is done sparsely and from a distance with judicious use of binoculars and spotting scopes. We must not stir things up that would send a warning signal into the animal's home turf zone. I make it a point to vary my approach and movements, choosing multiple stand locations for rotation. I seldom set the same stand twice in a row, and never more than three times. The wind is always number one, and I will never go to a stand that could possibly be compromised by the prevailing winds, either while on position or during my approach. This is ultra important. The surprise ambush is the only way. Scent and stealth is as important for scouting and travel to and from our stands as it is for our on-stand time. A surprise hit scenario is the best. Here are a few good ideas that work for me every season. Number one, do not park in the same location every time. If you're driving to your hunting grounds, vary your positioning. Of course, keep it as silent as possible, never slamming doors or clinking equipment, and get that muffler fixed. Number two, vary your approach to your stand or hunt zone as much as possible, quietly as possible. Not just route-wise, but time-wise as well. Get in a little earlier once in a while or a little bit later once in a while, and change it by an hour here and there. It does make a difference. Number three, if you only hunt certain days of the week, say Saturday and Sunday, take particular caution in breaking those patterns. Number four, avoid building permanent stands. A portable position just a few yards variant can make a big difference. If a buck has got you figured out in that oak tree, get up in that maple next time. And even if it's only a few yards difference, bingo. Rotate your stand as much as possible. Even avoiding mornings and afternoons from the same spot. A great idea is to silently move into your normal morning and evening stand in the middle of the day. You could be in for a real surprise. Next, let as many deer go by as you can. Patience is a virtue, and discipline is educational. The relaxed state of non-threatened game will be a powerful attractant to other game. Next, be smart about the type of scent product you use. Some work great, some don't work at all. Apple scent will spook game in an area where there is no apples. Don't use anything unnatural or foreign. Do not underestimate the value of patterning game and de-patterning yourself. The game hears and smells and sees and figures everything. And don't think for a minute that this applies just to deer and other big game. Pheasant and grouse hunters out there know exactly what I'm talking about. Slam a door and yell and talk it up as you enter a pheasant swamp or alder thicket and see a tenth of the birds that quiet, cautious hunters will. The stealth element is paramount to a predator's success rate. Better hunters are less intrusive and more difficult to figure out. Now, like all good hunting advice, it ain't always so. For example, I have found that when baiting for bear, obvious and repetitious patterning is beneficial. Bear oftentimes bed down near their food source, and they like to monitor activity in the area. I like to whistle and make a bunch of commotion, sort of ring the dinner bell for the old bear on my way in every day. I have even seen this work on deer and hog baits on occasion during bad mast years or in the dread of winter with reduced feed availability. The trick is, as usual, get to know the hunting area as thoroughly as possible. Aspire to know more than the game knows. Good luck. that is not really possible, but give it your best shot and be a smart hunter. After all, our brain is the only thing we've got on the animal kingdom, I think. The gentle, relaxed feeling we get when we're in the wild tends to soothe the savage beast within all of us. Soothing is cool as long as it doesn't put us to sleep. You must maintain an extreme level of awareness while at the same time being relaxed. There is a magic balance between enjoying the peace of our glorious hunting activities without losing that killer edge. I breathe easy in my comfortable perch in the old white oak, taking in all the sights and sensations of my surroundings, but I concentrate just enough on keeping poised, somewhat cocked, locked, and ready to rock, Doc, and ready to react at all times. I'm not that great of a hunter, but with my senses fine-tuned, I remain sprung and ready at the first window of opportunity that presents itself for that long-awaited, intensely anticipated moment, usually quite brief, for me to make the right maneuvers. It is usually now or never. I keep hearing from fellow hunters now how we can be caught off guard. I've noticed that. Don't get caught off guard. On guard. The mental game of archery. Compound this challenging accuracy contest with the variables of the hunt. And here, my friends, we have the supreme get-down test. As in the procedure, for an all-efficient target time demands focus, focus, focus. And then, of course, focus. We are articulating the act of sending our intimate projectile into a living animal and the causes a certain amount of psyche dancing. Shoot only a few arrows during practice sessions during the actual season. In fact, those that can discipline themselves to a single perfect arrow per session, they're going to be the deadliest archers amongst us. Laser eyes into the sweet spot every time will teach us consistent control. The desire to kill clean is paramount. Do not underestimate this pure functional facility. The best sport coaches of all times were and are dedicated to winning, not competing, winning. Every second of every walk in the wild is wonderful and top-notch on the stock of life. But how difficult is it to recall graphic details of every kill we have ever made? Those sensations are exhilarating and unique to the joy column of life no others hold. The name of the game is take it all in. Dwell on each stimulating thought, experience, and moment. The lessons alone are always worth the price of admission. But the kill is the clincher, no doubt. I have heard it said the kill is anticlimactic. Not for me. You can't eat memories. You have got to want that kill. Picture yourself in the eye of the storm, releasing that arrow or bullet straight into the vitals of that sure kill, and enjoy that feeling. It's called productivity. Even when we don't harvest game, we go home with just the most wonderful feelings, sensations, and memories that you can get anywhere in life. But the goal should be precision, function, focus, and backstraps. It wouldn't hurt to consider and anticipate multiple scripts. Play all the possible scenarios over and over again in the mind in anticipation of the setup and the shot. Literally envision the scene unfolding before your eyes, thinking out the moves before you make them. By looking over the terrain around us, we should think ahead to how we will react to any possible game encounter. Picture the arrival of an animal from various positions, placing our bodies in such a way to facilitate a smooth, undetectable shooting move. Anything can happen, and it usually does. So we must be flexible and prepared for anything, everything. Not easy, but the more varied presentations we anticipate, the better prepared we will be. That's what makes for a deadly hunter, preparedness. If blind spots exist from the tree stand or your ground blind, attempt to eliminate them without overexposing your stand. Do not clear too many shooting lanes or discount the need for some cover. Pay particular attention to obstructions that would interfere with necessary movement. Some compromise will usually be unavoidable, but use your best judgment. If you feel exposed, then you are. To make that kill, we must outthink survival instinct monsters. I love that part. Challenge is adventure. Ultimately, we've got to be prepared for meat. You've got to be prepared for that function that brings life's sustenance. Since we are looking for the kill, we must be totally prepared for the handling of this glorious gift of sustenance. Based on the variables of remoteness, weather, terrain conditions, and by how expeditiously we can get the meat cooled and processed, certain minimal extras will always be needed. I, of course, never leave home without certain tools. I carry the usual Victoria Knox Nugent Whackmaster pocket knife with the saw and all the good blades on it as part of my absolute gear. Plus, I always carry rubber gloves, 2 to 3 extra large Ziploc plastic bags, a cheesecloth game bag, the incredible product from Wyoming Liquid Game Bag, and some strong rope for possible hanging chores. I always keep the heart and liver in a Ziploc bag, and all the other stuff has its practical uses. Be a Boy Scout. Be prepared. Always try new experimental methods. Mock scrapes, horn rattling, calling, partner parallel still hunts, stalking, inclement weather hunts. Be creative and seek adventure while looking for the new improved maneuver. I am taking for granted that the huge list of hunter preparations have already been adhered to. Silent clothing and gear, accurized equipment, razor-sharp broadheads, perfectly straight balanced arrows, properly constructed ammo, wind and scent considerations, knowledge of the hunt ground, all safety and legal considerations. Safety, safety, safety. Did I mention safety? And the number one requirement to be a real hunter? Mindset. Remain determined to do it right and intently consider all the extreme possible scenarios that we may encounter out there. That is the difference between a casual hiker and a real hunter. And of course, all this will help with our number one goal, to have fun, live it up. Each and every hunt is sensual stimuli. Stimulate, my friends, and live it up. Go slow, but go. For archery, for bow hunting, for connecting with the wild, and for getting close to game and maximizing one's waking hours, I propose optimum, maximum alertness, decisiveness, aggressiveness, speed and smoothness, coolness, ruthlessness, surprise, and omniscience.